بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اللهم أصلح ذات بيننا وألف بين قلوبنا واجمع كلمتنا واجعلنا يا ربي دائما كما جمعتنا في هذا البيت الطاهر المبارك على طاعتك، فاجمعنا في الدنيا على محبتك وفي الآخرة تحت ظل عرشك وبصحبة نبيك الكريم مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. إن شاء الله like every Tuesday we are talking about Quran, and this is the best thing you could ever talk about. You feel the complete tranquility when you talk about the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the last few weeks, we're having like some introduction to get to the point of going over each and every surah in Quran and trying to pick the main theme of the surah. Maybe we'll pause a little bit with surah al-Fatiha, but we won't be able to, you know, have everything in details in terms of tafsir and interpretation for the whole surah. Otherwise, it will take us so much time. So the plan is, inshallah, for example, Surah Al-Baqarah. We will go over Surah Al-Baqarah to see the main themes, like the story of the cow, the story of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, and the story of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam and Sayyidina Ismail when they established and they raised the foundation of the sacred mosque, and so on. We'll just start with the main themes of each surah. So for today, inshallah, let's start with Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha is really important for each and every Muslim that we have to memorize it. And I'm sure everyone, alhamdulillah, memorized, have Surah Al-Fatiha memorized. Because of what? Because we need to read it in our prayers, right? And it's mandatory that our prayers is not going to be, you know, accepted. Our prayers is incorrect if Surah Al-Fatiha is not recited, right? So if we recite Surah Al-Fatiha every day in our prayers, I'm just talking about the fara'id, you know, the obligatory prayers, the five times a day prayers, let alone Salat al-Nafila. Just for Salat al-Fariidah, we are going to recite Surah Al-Fatiha 17 times a day. This gives us a message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that sometimes in our day-to-day life and in our process of education or our process of learning something, we feel, we tend to say that things get boring. That this imam is every day is sitting after Salat al-Fajr to say dua and dhikr, dua remembrance, dua supplication remembrance every day. This is actually the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah himself said to his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. If you go over the whole Quran, you can't find a word of like education or teach them in an imperative mode, like عَلِّمْهُمْ and so on. So it's kind of reminding things together. We are here to remind ourselves and everyone of what we already know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us all with a portion of knowledge that we need to revive, we need to bring into life, we need to practice it in our day-to-day life. That's why we, our mission, our basic mission, besides of course learning and teaching and education and everything, we are reminding everyone of Allah and of the knowledge that you already know, alhamdulillah. And I am noticing that the majority of the people, especially here in the masjid and in the community, they are, mashallah, most knowledgeable. May Allah bless you and benefit you from the knowledge, Allahumma ameen. So sometimes you feel like things are very repetitive. We are repeating. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was repeating himself. He was trying once, twice, and three times till the essence of the knowledge reach the heart of the believers. We will get to this point. If you read Surah Al-Fatiha, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He just said ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in Al-Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, once more ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Again, another reminder that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, the most gracious subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you hear something that you already know, say Alhamdulillah. I have a channel to remember Allah and to revive my soul and to bring the knowledge into practice. Because this is the point, as we mentioned before, that no matter how knowledge you have, how much knowledge you have, it's all about how much knowledge are we putting into action, the practice itself. مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَلِنَفْسِهِ. Every time you read إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, you'll find what's next? وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Unless Surah Al-Baqarah. So, always, al-amal is a proof of religion, is a proof of faith. It's all about how to practice. Okay. Besides that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. Our religion is perfect. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, today I perfected your religion, I've completed your religion. This means that nothing new will jump into the equation. It's like whatever trouble we have, whatever any experience we go through, if we get back to the Quran, we will find the answer. We'll find the solution in a way. That's why we are gathering, trying to extract from Quran, to dig deep into the meaning of Quran, so that we'll be able to understand, and accordingly, we'll be able, inshallah, to practice. So if you are from those who pray five times a day, and we have to, everyone, we are reciting Surah Al-Fatiha 17 times a day. The question is, have we ever looked into Surah Al-Fatiha? Have we ever tried to understand the meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha? If we get to the point of understanding and grasping and absorbing the meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha, our prayers will be in a different level. Our khushu' into salah will be completely different. It's like, how should we feel when we read Surah Al-Fatiha, when we recite Surah Al-Fatiha? What should be, you know, going on into our hearts, into our minds when we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, as we need to recite it every day 17 times, it should be great. A lot of questions. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose Surah Al-Fatiha specifically? There should be something special with this surah. Otherwise, the whole Quran is great. But to repeat it every day, 17 times at least, besides Salat al-Nafilah, besides your, you know, wird and your recitation, there should be something great embedded into this surah. Let's start and try to contemplate about the meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Bismillah, in the name of Allah. We start everything in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will find this Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning of each surah in Quran. Surah Al-Tawbah is excluded. So, we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and focus on this. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the most gracious, the most merciful. Of all the attributes of Allah, of all the names of Allah, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala chose these two names and these two attributes to start not only Surah Al-Fatiha, but every chapter, every surah in Quran. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. They say that Islam is a deen of corruption, is a deen of oppression, is a deen of terrorism, is a deen of this and that. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose these two names to start every single surah in Quran with. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the most gracious, the most merciful. How much rahmah, how much mercy does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have? Let's think about it. The strongest bond in the world is the bond between the mother and the baby. Okay? The breastfed baby. And even in studies that's been done recently, they said that if two children to one mother, one of them is breastfed and the other is bottle-fed, the one that's breastfed will be having a strongest relationship to his mother throughout his life. This is great. And we all know how we love our mothers and how our mothers love us. But no wonder if at a point in time you hear that a mother disowned their children for any reason. Everywhere in the world, it's rare, but it happens, right? The father is the same. The father, we are so proud of our kids. We feel like we want to give them our soul and our hearts. But at a point in time, there might be like a conflict between the father and the kids. You work for your boss for 20 or 30 years, but at a point in time, there are some procedures and some laws. If you break these procedures, you are fired. Allah is the only one that says, "O my slave, do whatever you want. If you come to me with repentance, I'll always forgive." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He says subhanahu wa ta'ala in the holy hadith, al-hadith al-Qudusi, if your sins is to reach the heaven, if your sins will fill up the whole earth, and you come to me, and you do not associate partners with me, I will come to you with forgiveness and mercy that matches it. لو بلغت ذنوبك عنان السماء ثم جئتني لا تشرك بي شيئا غفرت لك ما كان منك ولا أبالي. يا ابن آدم لو جئتني بقراب الأرض معصية ثم جئتني لا تشرك بي شيئا لأتيتك بقرابها مغفرة. لا يفعل الله بعذابكم إن شكرتم وآمنتم. Allah does not want to punish anyone. This one, he made it clear for us. وهديناه النجدين. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left us on the, as we say, المحجة البيضاء. Everything is clear. Do's and don'ts. Do this and don't do that. This is completely clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Say, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O my slaves, those who have transgressed against themselves, never, ever give up hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the holy hadith, O son of Adam, if you come to me a handspan, I'll come to you an arm's length. An arm's length. If you come to me walking, I come to you running. If you remember me, I remember you. If you forget me, I still remember you. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is repeating Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He is stressing the point. He is emphasizing the meaning of Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Feel it when you pray your salah. And have this feeling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. Let me ask you a simple question. Have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never let you down? No. Allah never let us down. Allah never disappointed us. Because we do believe that even we lose anything in this life, we know that there are some rewards, a lot of rewards, and we know that these rewards may be in dunya or it's waiting for us in the hereafter. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam يقول حتى الشوك التي تصيب المؤمن يثاب عليه. Everything, every test, every ابتلاء, very tiny, small, big, great, it takes a day, it takes years, no matter what, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you the compensation of maghfirah and jannah. أولئك جزاؤهم مغفرة من ربهم وجنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار. So, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. That all praises due to Allah. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول والحمد لله تملأ الميزان. On the day of judgment, there will be a scale. And you know that. One scale for the good deeds and the other end of the scale is for the bad deeds. We should be smart enough to try to fill up the end of the good deeds. The Prophet ﷺ gives you like the manual. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and keep saying Alhamdulillah. The more you say Alhamdulillah, the more you fill up your scale with hasanat. The more you save yourself, the more you expose yourself to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine that if you keep saying Alhamdulillah all the time and you act accordingly, and you raise your hand to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for anything, you'll be exposed to the rahmah and the responding of your dua even way more than any other one. Because you have a connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time. Please, brothers, have this in mind. Our connection, our relationship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not just when we have a trouble. لذلك نقول الدعاء كالماء وليس كالدواء. When do we take the medicine? When we feel pain, right? When we are in pain, when we feel sick. But if we are good, we don't take medicine. But how many times do we drink water? Every day. Okay, every time. We could just, you know, grab a bottle of water or a cup of water and drink. So, the same mindset with dua should be like drinking water. Because actually, and we all, sometimes we fall into this trap. That we, you know, indulge into the material life, we forget to remember Allah and to say tasbih and to say istighfar and to make dua day after day. I mean, subhanAllah, as you can see, days are flying. They're not just fast, they're flying. You know, tomorrow is Wednesday, Thursday, and then Khutbah al-Jum'ah. I feel like Khutbah al-Jum'ah was yesterday. The week is turned to like a day. Days are flying. And this is actually this one of the signs of as-sa'ah, yawm al-qiyamah, qillat al-barakah fi al-waqt. This also pushes us to wake up. It's like a wake-up call that we need to give back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say Alhamdulillah, we need to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time. And Allah will always be there for us. What's next? Sallu ala Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. It's a kind of glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we confess that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of the worlds. When we say the Lord of the worlds, you know, actually when we live in a city, in a big city, if you're not traveling, if you're not going out of the state, you feel like this might be the biggest place in the world. But if you think about how America is big, you find subhanAllah, it's very big, 50 states. But if you are exposed to a video or so that, you know, shows you that the countries around the country, you'll find subhanAllah how big this world is. It's so big. Well, let's jump to another point. The sun. They say that the sun is 1,000,000 times bigger than the earth. Okay? And this sun and all of the planets around it is in just one galaxy in the outer space. And there are, you know, a bunch of galaxies in the outer space. And all of these things and all of these huge, something even beyond our grasp, all of these things are just in the first heaven. What about the second heaven and the third and the fourth? The distance between the first heaven to the second heaven is a distance of 500 years. From the second heaven to the third heaven is a distance of 500 years. From the third to the fourth, fourth to fifth, fifth to sixth, is a distance of 500 years. And above all of that, the ocean. And above all of that, the arsh, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. we feel arrogant? And how come we allow ourselves to get into any kind of argument? We are so small. We should be so humble to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we need the mercy of Allah. If we look at ourselves, comparing to the earth, and the earth to the sun, and to the planets, and to the galaxy, and to the outer space, and to the heavens, and to the... It's, subhanAllah, it's tremendous. This is why we say, رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of all of these things. The Lord of the world, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, alhamdulillah, رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. فِي السَّمَاءِ البيت المعمور حكى عنه القرآن الكريم والبيت المعمور صحيح؟ قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن هذا البيت المعمور يعني فيما معناه يدخله كل يوم أو يطوف حوله كل يوم 70,000 ملك 70,000 ملك كل يوم يمشي واللي يدخل لا يدخله ثانية أبدا يعني كل يوم 70,000 ملك جداد غير اللي كانوا امبارح وغير بتوعهم. So there is a house in the heavens. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells that every single day there is a 70,000 angels go and make tawaf around this house and they never come back. This is also in the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is huge, tremendous when we think about it in terms of numbers, right? So, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Just imagine that when you are standing in front of Allah to say, Allahu Akbar, we need to feel who is we are standing before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is between you and Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. No one could be between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you make sujood to Allah, imagine that if we are just 50 persons here in the masjid, for now, we are all make sujood at once, all together, behind Imam. And then you're asking Allah for something. I ask Allah for something different. And you ask Allah for something different. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heals everyone. And He gives everyone according to our benefit. Wallahu ya'lamu wa antum la ta'lamun. So when we say Allahu Akbar to enter our salah, let's try to elevate our rank in terms of feeling khushu' into our salah. When we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, to know how many times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave our sins. And how many times did we, made a promise with Allah and we broke our promise. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again, He accepted us. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. مالك يوم الدين الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم one more time مالك يوم الدين the Lord of the day or the King of the day of judgment. I don't want to go to this point today. Let's just focus on the first like half of surah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين the Lord of the worlds الرحمن الرحيم. Again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is emphasizing that He is the most merciful, the most gracious subhanahu wa ta'ala. نسأل الله تعالى أن يتغمدنا جميعا برحمته. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow His mercy upon us and to involve us with His mercy and forgiveness and to allow us always to be on the straight path and to be one hand, serving each other, bringing peace and tranquility to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to make us exchange the knowledge and to feel khushu' and to feel the greatness of the masjid and how we should be reacting towards the ni'am and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Inshallah next week we'll be continuing with Surah Al-Fatiha. It takes us just one more session inshallah. Jazakumullah khairan and let's feel it inshallah. From now on we'll recite it in our salah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.